Yo, 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 it's your boy Skiddy here with the love-hate relationship that I have with Netflix's Avatar The Last Airbender. So let's get into it. I have to say, after watching the series, I again have a love-hate relationship with it. I feel as though that the bending was awesome. Also notice the ethnicities of each nation and their breakdowns. For instance, you had the Earth Nation, which was, the Earth Kingdom, which, had a big plot of land, and they were more, Persian, Middle Eastern look, which I dug that. But then you had Kyoshi Island, which was separated from the Earth Kingdom. For those who don't remember why the island, Kyoshi Island, was separated, was because Avatar Kyoshi separated and she was like, I got my people over here, I don't want to do nothing with y'all. But that's here, neither here nor there. But I did love that feel. The Fire Nation had that wushu Chinese type feel to it. And then you had the Water Tribes, which felt more Eskimo, indigenous. I definitely love that. That definitely gave some good dynamics with the people. Bending, superb, absolutely 100% better than what we got in that movie that will not be named. It was definitely smooth. The Earthbenders didn't do a whole stomp the yard set to throw three pebbles. It was definitely refreshing. Again, there's the love hate. So here's a bit of hate coming. I will have to say, Gordon Cormier, it's the young man who played Aang. He captured a realistic version of Aang where, he was more lighthearted. He kept having to remind himself of what Monkey Atsu taught him, which was great. I did like that dynamic. However, Katara, she captured her essence, but I think they just need a little bit more, I would say, lessons in their transitioning with emotions. I also do know with putting live action, making an anime or even video games, when you transfer from animation to live action, it's hard to get those emotions, copy those emotions or even, write them in a way where the actor could capture that. It's definitely difficult. Sokka, he had fewer comedic moments. It felt like they made him more serious than usual. He was played by an Ian Owsley. I'm not too sure these young actors that I know, for the most part, they did capture the essence. I just feel as though that their transition with emotions needs a little bit more work. So that was kind of the hate thing for me, Gotta get that acting up. Zuko, played by Dallas James Liu. I have to say his performance was outstanding. He captured the rage, he captured the confusion, the yearning for his father's approval. I definitely felt that he took the horns with Zuko. Giving shout outs to my man Paul Hyung Lee, who played Uncle Iroh. Uncle Iroh, it's funny, it's fun watching him work because, now that to all my Avatar, fans out there, when you watch the series again, watch the animated series again, or when you watch this live action series, you go back and you're like, oh, okay, I see how Iroh was trying to switch it up, trying to, stall Zuko for a little bit. But I loved he captured the essence of Uncle Iroh. Spot on, definitely stayed true to the character. Zhao. I'm gonna say it again. Commander Zhao. Zhao the Moonslayer. I'm not going front. Ken Leong did his thing. Ken Leong, if y'all don't know him, he's been on many things, such as Inhumans, but what we know him as, for a while we called him Jun Tao, but he wasn't Jude Tao. He was Jude Tao's right-hand man on Rush Hour 1. The character's name was Sang. He definitely captured the ambitiousness of Zhao. I mean, I'm talking about the sneaky, underhanded, sending hidden messages to Ozai. You know what I mean? Like, he was that. He definitely. I'm basically saying this was those three saved the show. I mean, yeah, but they saved the show. I think Azula's issue was more so writing. It seems like they wanted to play on her not keeping her cool. Thing is that Azula, you know, again on the animated series, she was a menace. Like, she was a problem. She was one of the few firebenders that knew lightning bending. You know what I mean? Like, they tapped on to that, but it was more like she was more of a nuisance than a problem on the live action show. I also didn't like the fact that her friends didn't get no action. I mean, they got screen time, but they didn't get no action. Which, I mean, you really didn't see them until book two, which is another issue that I have with this series. Now, again, I've stated with animations or even games that have so much continuity, you know, there's no chance you should mess it up. Like, I mean, make it your own, but I mean, come on. They took fan favorite episodes from book one and book two, merged them together, because again, the tale of two lovers with the cave, that shouldn't have been in the first season. Well, correction, it should have been later when they were going back to Omashu. But again, that's that for me. That was one of the situations where when they did that, since they changed the timeline of certain events, it messed up on a lot of character developments. Hence, like the situation with Ko, the face stealer, played by my man George Sakai. He definitely lended his voice for a great character. I'm letting you know there's going to be some spoilers that I will be mentioning that goes with the hate part of this segment. But my whole thing was, when did Aang get the power to be able to take people into the spirit realm with him if they're not focused and concentrating? That was weird to me. Now, for all those people that be like, well, Zaire and Katara did it. Remember, Zaire was already in tune with his spirituality. He meditated. He was the only airbender after 1,000 years that could fly. Then, you know, Korra, she was the avatar. So they both were meditating to get into the spirit realm. Sokka nor Katara was meditating to get into the spirit realm. That definitely was a flaw. Definitely was a flaw. Now, the reason why I didn't mess with the Tale of Two Lovers shoehorn situation was because during that time, Aang was with Bumi. Now, again, they separated them, and I think they knew they messed up, so they made it up to have them together in the spirit world. And even though, you know, they did the Ko's voice right, my whole thing was Ko didn't feed on despair. He fed on faces. You had to show emotion. It didn't matter if it was despair, happiness, whatever. If you showed emotion, if you smirked, he got your face. And that's, again, goes back to me saying, once you take the core of a character and change it, you mess up the development. I didn't like how they had less hand-to-hand combat. You know, with Avatar, not only did we, you know, the animated series, not only did we fall in love with the, you know, the bending, but we fell in love with the martial arts that was backed by the bending. Definitely loved the fight scenes that were happening that were hand to hand. It was very few moments in the live action series where people were actually fighting hand to hand it was more bending versus bending. And I definitely would have, I would have loved to see more hand-to-hand combat. A gripe, another gripe with mines, man, I didn't like how Monk Yatsu got taken out. I didn't like that. I didn't like that the fact that, you know, one of the questions that, you know, all Avatar fans have been asking was, yo, what did Monk Yatsu do? You know, how did he have all those corpses of firebenders around him? And then it's like they kind of like dumbed down on him a little bit, where it was like, oh, dude, like, what's going on, man? I mean, he was still cool, but I liked his little fight sequence. But again, man, I definitely would have liked to see him take out like a squad of firebenders. That would have been fire. So yeah, I definitely had my gripe with that. Again, just like Azula, I feel as though Bumi was an issue more of writing than the acting. You don't know who King Bumi is? King Bumi, he's King of Omashu. He's known as the crazy king. People think he's gone senile, but nah, Bumi's just ahead of his time and he's just wild. He thinks outside the box. That's why he's one of my favorite characters on the animated series. The way they did the test on here, on the live action series, they changed the dynamic and the time frame of what happened. Bumi, you know, they again, don't fan service something and miss with it. It was enjoyable to watch, like I said before. It was enjoyable to watch, but it still had situations where, you know, you were questioning, should they continue a live action series of the Avatar? My rating, I give it a 6 out of 10. If you're a fan, be ready to be disappointed on certain aspects, but be ready to enjoy some moments. So it's your boy Skiddy giving you the heads up on the Netflix live action Avatar. Tell me what you think about it. Tell me what you like. Don't forget, like, share, subscribe. Unlimited Mags. It's your boy Skiddy. Deuces.